Our first story tonight, getting the big picture. And we mean big picture. All right. So there's a new observatory going in Chile, up on the Sierra Tololo in Chile. This is the Rubin Observatory, named after the astronomer Vera Rubin. And this is an image of it as it existed, as it was in May of this year. And it's progressing really well. They will start data taking sometime next year, and they'll actually move into actually operational in 2022, I believe. Now, this has got a huge mirror in it, okay? This is the mirror blank before it was aluminized to have its reflective surface. It's an 8 meters across. This image just shows you just how huge this mirror is. You can do that in a ground-based telescope. And with a mirror this big, you also need to have a big detector. Well, they have one, and it's called LSST-CAM. All right, and this is a combination of many, many CCDs put together at the prime focus of the Rubin telescope. And it's just an amazing new detector. Okay, so here are some characteristics of LSST-CAM. First of all, the field of view is 7 full moons across. Okay, it's 40 full moons across the whole detector. That is huge. There is a huge field of view, but it also has incredible resolution. As you can see on the right, they've got this picture where you can't really see, is there a golf course in there somewhere? Yes, there is, obviously. And they can actually resolve the golf ball on the golf course. They say they can see a golf ball from 15 miles away. All right. Now, it's great resolution, especially for ground-based, but you know, ground-based does have its limits. Hubble has 4 times better resolution than LSST-CAM, but hey, Hubble's in space. Hubble doesn't have the atmosphere to look through, so you know, it does amazing things. It's going to be huge, and so this detector that I showed you is now operational, and they wanted to test it, so they did a pinhole camera to test it. And this is one of their test images. 3.2 billion pixels, 3.2 gigapixels, right? You know, I mean, you may be impressed that your phone has, you know, we used to be impressed that our phones had 1 megapixel or 5 megapixel, now 10 megapixel, 40 megapixel, no, 3.2 gigapixels here, okay? This image that they used to test it is actually Vera Rubin processing some of her data. And they took that image, they use a pinhole camera to spread it out across the entire thing to get a test image. All right? And so they now are beginning to characterize the detector. They're being able to figure out all of the various details of it and showing that they really do have 3.2 billion pixels to work with. And this really, you know, it made me sort of think about, wow, where are we going to go in the next decade? All right, so this is a Hubble image, right? This is a Hubble image of stars in the Andromeda galaxy. And there's so much detail in a Hubble image. But as you can see on the right, that's a tiny, tiny region in the halo of the Andromeda galaxy, okay? For Hubble to see the entire galaxy, it would be really, really difficult. But we tried. We actually did make a Hubble mosaic called the Panchromatic Hubble Andromeda Treasury Program, or the FAT program. And at Orange Square, that's one Hubble detector. And we had to take like 300 images to cover basically about 1/3 of the Andromeda galaxy, as you see on the right. So Hubble has been able to cover that much. And if you came to our previous talks about the what used to be called the WFIRST is now the Roman Space Telescope, you can see that learned that the Roman telescope has 18 different detectors spread out over a much larger region. And that Roman, as shown on the right, can do all that Hubble did in its 300 or so pointings in like 2 or 3 pointings. So Roman will have a huge field of view. But even that is not the same as what Rubin will have, because when we compare Roman to Rubin, Ruben will be able to get the entire Andromeda galaxy in one image. Wow, that's what we're going to get. We're going to go from, you know, these 16 megapixels images from Hubble, and we put them all together to make them even bigger, but we're going to get 3.2 billion pixels with every image from the Ruben telescope. We're going to have a smorgasbord of data over the next couple, over the next decade. Our second story tonight, it's the Greater Pumpkin, Edwin Hubble. We have a lot of international viewers, and they may not get the reference. In the United States, we have a tradition of a Halloween program called It's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. I think Peanuts is probably worldwide, but this TV program came out in 1966. And our news chief decided, well, we got to have some sort of tie-in for Halloween. So we found an image, and it sort of looks like a pumpkin. And here is that image. These are the interacting galaxies NGC 2292 and 2293. What you've got going on here is those white eyes. Those are the cores of the galaxies that are mixing together. And all the other material around it is the galaxies as they've smashed together and are now mixing it up. And down bottom, you see the dark dust lane, okay? That dust lane, there's a little bit of star formation going on. That sort of forms the smile of the jack-o'-lantern, okay? And when they found this, they said, all right, we got to do this for a Halloween release. And it looks sort of like a pumpkin, so we'll call it the Greater Pumpkin. I actually think it looks a little bit more like Jack Skellington from The Nightmare Before Christmas. But I guess making the Jack Skellington reference isn't the same, although he is the Pumpkin King. But that was our Halloween release to show off the interacting galaxies and how cool they can look. All right, we have one more story for you, and it's a really special one. We are celebrating a century of cosmic inquisitivity. Now, I've been doing the public lecture series for almost 20 years now. 19 years I have been hosting it. And most of my time that I've been hosting it, I have seen one particular member of the audience down in the front row. And she has just turned 100 years old. So we are going to shout out to Molly Wittow from Baltimore, Maryland, who is 100 years young this month, okay? Molly is amazing. She comes to the public lecture series when we're able to have it in person, and she sits in and she's always got inquisitive questions. She's told me that she's gone and seen several solar eclipses over her life. And so I was gonna sing for you guys, but you know, you really don't want that. I'm not a singer, but I am a visualizer. So Molly, for your birthday, we have an observation of the Birthday Cake Nebula visualized just for you. Happy birthday, Molly. Everybody, go to the chat on YouTube and type in your happy birthday congratulations from Molly, who is 100 years old this month.